enough, I've had enough, and then they are ready to take that first and often most difficult step toward dealing with their disease. So it was with me. With all I had outwardly, I had lost almost everything inwardly. I had reached my bottom as surely as the addict on Skid Row. I remember clearly my fourth day in the hospital sitting in a session with a group of male addicts, trying to remain somewhat aloof from the wretched individuals around me. After all, I was a physician, not a bum. And the man who was leading the session, noting my arrogance, suddenly turned and staring icily at me asked, "What do you think about all this, junkie?" Something inside me snapped at that moment, and as the tears welled up in my eyes, I sank into the deepest depression I had ever known, only to be followed by a clearer vision of who I am than I had ever had before, and from that moment on I was able to say without hesitation or qualification, "I'm an addict." That has made all the difference. I began to change over the next few weeks and I began to attend NA meetings regularly. I initially felt that it would be impossible to attend more than one or two meetings a week. It just wouldn't fit in with my busy schedule. I later learned that my priorities were 110 degrees reversed. It would be everything else that would have to fit into my meeting schedule. An individual much wiser than I told me that my recovery had to come first, before everything else in my life, before my wife and children, before my job and my friends, because if I didn't make that commitment, I would lose all those things anyway. So first things first, not using is the bottom line and all else follows. My program now consists of attending meetings regularly, reading the literature, and following the 12 steps to the best of my ability. I have learned the meaning of the word honest, both with others and myself, and I am slowly learning that once foreign word, humility. The program has not only given me a way of not using drugs a day at a time, but has also given me a program of living, also a day at a time, that had previously been unknown to me. I have learned that in NA there is a veracity to such sayings as, "I can, but we can," and "keep coming back to meetings." Most of all, I am learning to accept myself for what I am. Recently, I went on a skiing vacation in the mountains and I sought out the fellowship of addicts at a meeting there. It was heartwarming to be immediately welcomed into a new group so far from home, where I again met Physician Addict 165. People from all walks of life united by our common bond. It's a fellowship that I cherish, for these people are helping me to stay drug-free and helping me to maintain my intellectual as well as physical recovery. Recovery is a healing process from which I am emerging stronger and more able to face the tasks ahead of me. It is sad that we must pass through such hell before reaching the serenity of peace of mind in recovery. Over the gates of Dante's Inferno is a sign which reads, "Abandon all hope, ye who enter here." They fit well the portals of the addict's personal hell. It has been a slow but progressive passage back through those gates into a world where there is once again hope for those who follow the NA program and its 12 steps out of the abyss of addiction. As the years pass, I am sure that the growing awareness and understanding of addiction by the medical profession will parallel a public awareness which will make Narcotics Anonymous and its program more prescient of the world of the addict. 166 Narcotics Anonymous. Part of the solution. Living on a farm as a child, I felt inferior and was shy around other people. I was full of fear and became very angry when things didn't go my way. This behavior continued during my adolescent years. When I was 21 years old, I married and still continued to try and change reality, wanting everyone to agree with me, thinking I was right and reacting with temper tantrums when people disagreed with me. I became a mother of three children. With my first child, I still felt in control. With my second, I became overwhelmed. With my third, I felt desperate. I wanted somebody to take care of me, rather than me taking care of others. Being responsible as a mother frightened me. Wanting to be perfect made me feel more scared and angry. One day my husband went to our minister hoping something could be done for me since I was so angry toward him and life in general. The minister didn't feel he could help me, so they found a psychologist in a city 200 miles away for me to drive to and from for weekly appointments. It was at this time that a mild tranquilizer was prescribed for me by a doctor who was a friend of the psychologist. The psychologist was kind and tried to be helpful. He thought that seeing him and taking medication would help me with my anger. Hopefully, I would start coping with reality better. It wasn't long until the psychologist thought I would be better if I were put on a different tranquilizer, so with the help of the doctor, my prescription was changed. Still, my attitude did not change, so it was decided that our family should move to the city where my psychologist lived and this would solve the marital problems caused by my anger. It was very early in my pill popping that I became dependent on them, thinking that I could not exist without their help. We continued to move as my husband's jobs changed throughout the Midwest. Eventually, I remember sitting in a rocking chair and the thought of suicide crossed my mind, yet I told myself that my life wasn't unmanageable. Today, I believe that moment is when I cross from dependency to addiction. 166. Part of the solution. 167. Continuing to use, abuse and overdosing my pills, I ended up in a hospital in the psychiatric ward. It was at this time that I needed a psychiatrist to visit me in the hospital to help me with my problems. The psychiatrist came in and told me, "You don't like yourself very well, do you?" I said, "You aren't telling me anything I don't know." I left the hospital in a few days, and came home with the understanding that I would see the psychiatrist weekly. I would go to the psychiatrist's office and things didn't seem to get any better. I was fearful that he would take my prescriptions for my pills away from me because I was not taking them as prescribed. Changing my prescription from one brand of pills to another brand didn't seem to help. When I didn't have enough tranquilizers to take, I would take the antidepressant. I expected the pills to be a miracle cure for reality. I went to great lengths to get attention during my addiction. One day I turned on the gas before my husband came home, making sure I turned it off before he came in the door, thinking he would be alarmed and express care about what happened to me. He was alarmed and decided, with the help of the minister and psychiatrist, that I needed to go to the hospital for more help. I knew from past experience that psychiatric wards didn't seem to help me with my mental problems. Things things calmed down for a while with me changing brands again and seeing the psychiatrist to renew my prescription. In the meantime, I was visiting a social worker, telling her when I was on one of the tranquilizers, taking it as prescribed, making the world okay. I wonder why everybody isn't taking this type of drug, I thought. Approximately 6 weeks later, the effects of the pills wore off and I was abusing them. When the tranquilizers were running low, I'd overdose the antidepressants and toss and turn in bed feeling terrible but still using, abusing, and overdosing them. One night after taking several antidepressants, I ended up in the hospital on the cardiac ward, lying to the nurses about which pills I had taken and being told that I should feel lucky to be going home so soon. However, I didn't feel lucky or care about living. I was a pill counter, making sure I had enough of my drug of choice, tranquilizers, left in my cupboard, thinking this was the way to face reality, by taking pills each day. One evening I dissolved 50 aspirin in a glass of water, drank it until my ears rang, then dumped the rest of it out. This caused attention to be focused on me in a negative manner. 168 Narcotics Anonymous. Eventually my husband and I parted, and I remarried. Less than a month into my second marriage I became angry. It was a different thing, pills in my hand, thinking, I have no reason to take them, and swallowing the handful anyway. After sharing with my husband what I had done, he suggested I call him.
Starting in
far back as I could remember, before I started school as a child, up to the time when I came off drugs. I named the names of the people I resented, remembering I was taking my own inventory and not that of others. Part of the solution 169. The fifth step I took with my first sponsor. With her I shared the dark side of my life and, eventually, relief and freedom have come into my life. My understanding is that if I share the wrongs I have done, then the good spiritual feelings will automatically become a part of my life. The sixth step reminds me to become entirely ready to become honest, open-minded and willing to have my defects of character removed. I listed my defects in the inventory I wrote down, and in time more have been revealed to me a day at a time. Through working the 12 steps, the obsession and compulsion to use will be removed. Having my shortcomings removed is a goal to strive for the rest of my days. It's been shared that the 6th and 7th steps are often the forgotten steps of the program. I ask each day to have my anger removed from my life. I made a list of the people that I had harmed and have made direct amends to them, including my children. Each day I am making amends in morning, say it when you think of it. When I heard this, I started making a business each day of saying, please. I read literature from both fellowships and go to step meetings to help me grow spiritually. My way of living before I was an addict and after I became one didn't work, so I have had to work the steps and try to practice them in my daily living so I can become useful and whole. Today, I'm grateful to be a part of the solution, rather than the problem. 170 Narcotics Anonymous. Resentment at the world. I had living problems before I ever started using drugs. At an early age, I developed a strong resentment against alcohol. I was hit by a car and the driver was drunk. Later I had resentments toward days after I was raped. I had resentments towards my parents after I found out that I was born illegitimate. By the age of 13, I hated almost everyone. I also started using at that age. My first experience with drugs was smoking pot and drinking alcohol. It relieved me of all my pain. Although I did get sick, that didn't matter. I loved it anyway and I set out to find ways not to get sick. I didn't drink very much after that. I started getting in trouble at home and at school. I was blaming my troubles on authority. I started rebelling at school, and I refused to communicate in any way with my father. Things just kept getting worse. If I didn't have pot, I felt very lonely and left out. At about this time, I lost my ability to think clearly and as a result I got thrown off the football team. I became very resentful over this. I blamed it on one of my teammates because he told the coach that I was smoking pot. At about this time, my parents decided to move because of my reputation. They thought if I moved away, I would get better. This, of course, didn't work. Wherever I went, my disease went with me. In the new town, I was introduced to harder drugs and I used them because they took me further away from reality. I started using acid and speed heavily, and I also started healing. After a short time, I was busted for healing in school and I was sent to jail. This was the first of many times to come. I was repeatedly getting busted in school, so as soon as I could, I quit school. After that, I hit the streets. I was healing acid and using it very heavily. The progression of the disease set in. I kept getting locked up. I had no one, and I would do anything to get my drug. As time went on, I just kept getting more into acid. Everyone told me I was living in a fantasy world, and I was. I wouldn't live in reality at all. 170. Resentment of the world 171. I had no time for it in my world. My spirituality had changed from Roman Catholic to Satanism. I felt like I had no place in any kind of good world. I had tried to stop using many times, but it never worked because I couldn't deal with the world. I started to try suicide about this time. I didn't feel that I had any reason to live, but I was too afraid of death to kill myself. I felt totally insane after my last suicide attempt. I tried to kill my brother. At that time, my mother threw me out. When I was packing to leave, it hit me that I was really sick, and I asked to be committed to a mental institution. I saw a psychiatrist and he recommended a drug detox. I wanted help, so I went. When I was in detox, I was introduced to Narcotics Anonymous and I finally felt like I fit in somewhere. They showed me the 12 steps of recovery and told me that if I used them I'd get better. Having been beaten enough, I admitted to the first step and I felt relieved. The second step was hard for me to do at first, but I used the group as a power greater than myself. To believe in God, I had to pray for faith and shortly the belief came to me. At this time, I took a third step, which I followed by a fourth and fifth step. At that time, I experienced a relief and freedom as I hadn't experienced any time in life. I used the rest of the steps to keep my life in order, and a sponsor helped me do the steps. Now I go to meetings at least 6 times a week. In meetings, I found that I can share with other people involved with recovery. We have a common bond. A few months ago, I went to my first service conference, which gave me the faith to start new meetings in the area where I live. At the time, we only had 1 meeting a week and now there are 7 meetings a week. Being involved in service makes me feel worthwhile. 172 Narcotics Anonymous. Mid Pacific Serenity. I am a happy, grateful drug addict, clean by the grace of God and the 12. Steps of Narcotics Anonymous. Life today is fulfilling and there is joy in my heart. It wasn't always this way. I drank and used drugs for 12 years, on a daily basis for 10 of them. I was an addict of the hopeless variety. It really seems to me that I was born this way. I was born and raised in Southern California, in a loving middle-class family. Both my sister and I were wanted, loved children and were shown that in every way. As far back as I can remember, I have felt separate from this family and all of life. Of course, I am talking of an intense fear of life. I cannot remember feeling the simplicity of being a child. I had the addict's personality growing up. Self will run riot. I always wanted my own way, and if I didn't get it, I sure let everyone know. Growing up in Southern California, I seemed to get into all the normal things. Going to the beach, getting into sports, yet always the tears and feelings of inadequacy never let me live up to my potential. I was an average student throughout school, had lots of friends yet I withdrew, dominated by the fear. I guess I was about 15 when I tried my first drug, alcohol. From the first drink it was oblivion. Finally I had found freedom from fear, or so I thought. From the beginning I identified with the rejects, the people who slept on the beach, under the piers. As I look back over these 12 years, I see how I loved each new drug I tried. Alcohol was only the beginning. If it got me loaded, I wanted to try it and I always wanted more. It didn't matter if it was sniffing glue or shooting the best coke or heroin. I wasn't a rich, cheesy addict. I just needed to stay high and all my energy was put into that direction. I quit school in the 12th grade. Surfing had become part of my life, so it was off to Hawaii. My parents were very confused about their son who didn't do a very good job of hiding his desperation. To all who were sane and living life, I appeared very lost and unhappy. You see, it was a 172. Mid Pacific Serenity 173. Very short time after I started using, that the alcohol and drugs were doing for me what they did in the beginning. The fear had returned, only much worse than before. My first trip to Hawaii in 1962 was only the beginning of many more to come, always trying to run from myself. Hawaii was, and is, a paradise, but I only saw it through the eyes of being loaded. Thanks to the warm weather, it was easy to pursue the only life I knew. The way of life was to wander the streets and sleep in parked cars or other available shelters. At the age of 19, I was back in Hawaii for the third time, a full-blown addict and so lost and confused I only knew I had to drink and use drugs and there was no other way. Returning to California at the end of the summer of 1963, I found myself joining the Navy. Being lost, that seemed to be the easiest thing to do, just sign my name. It was easier than looking for a job. I was so burned out already and wanted something different, yet didn't know how to ask for help. The Navy, of course, was not the answer. The drugs continued and after 2 years I was discharged. The psychiatrist said my mind had become disordered from the use of marijuana and LSD, plus I had jumped overboard in rage at the Navy. I convinced myself that once I got out of the Navy things would be different. No one would be telling me what to do, but I met a new friend at this point, the world of fixing. This was in 1965 and the next 6 years were the worst years of my life. As I see it today, those years got me into the program. After getting out of the Navy, I got married. How and why this woman married me is a mystery even today. On our wedding night, I shot some dope and slept on Venice Beach with my dogs.